Hey everyone, welcome to the SML Show presented by OGIO Powersports and Yamaha Motors. I'm Donn Maeda and I'm joined here by my favorite Euro dude, Dylan Woodcock. So, buddy, how did you get to become like the coolest UK supercross rider?
Probably by not riding any motocross and just riding supercross. But I don't know, just enjoy myself, always say hello, try to smile at everyone and yeah, try to be cool guy with everyone, you know what I mean?
Yeah. Okay, so you are supercross only pretty much, right? You don't dabble in nationals here or at home or GPs?
No, it's like we was talking about this weekend being like a mud race. The last kind of muddiest race I've ever done was San Diego. And then I rode a motocross.
Oh, Limegate.
Yeah. And I rode a motocross race this year on a 125 just out of British, and it was so muddy for me. Like, yeah. That was the last time I really rid outdoors, so I don't ride any outdoors, just work in the summer and come out here, enjoy the weather normally, and that's it.
Oh, nice. So you work when you're not racing?
Yeah, I work back home when I'm not racing, doing some sort of anything I can get some sort of money, you know.
But yeah. What kind of work do you do?
I'm realistically want to be a stuntman and be on the BSR stunt register, but I'll do anything, building, brickwork, delivering parcels, anything I can do. Working in Amazon sometimes.
Stunt work. Have you done stunt work in the UK or?
Yeah, just in the UK. Here you need a SAG card and back in England you need like six disciplines. And my father's obviously been big in the stunt world. So I'm just trying to follow his footsteps really and get the skills ticked off while still racing supercross and being young and enjoying it all, you know what I mean?
Yeah. So your dad is a stuntman?
Yeah. He's a stuntman. He's been a stunt coordinator now for a good couple of years. So
really?
Yeah, he's done some big
it
films.
It feels like you would have a foot in the door or like a little in there.
Yeah. My dad doesn't give it to me too easy.
No?
You got to work for it. It's the same with anything, you know. If you don't know how it all works, it's same with bikes. Mm-hmm. If you're not good enough, you don't get on the good teams. And if you are, you get the luxuries. So it's the same with stunts. If you're not a stuntman, you don't get the work. And when you are, you get the work. So,
what kind of stunts did he do?
He's done all sorts of stuff, like he's quite little, so he's doubled a few women and like car crashes and kids and stuff like that. Harry Potter, Gulliver's Travels, all kinds of stuff.
I think Dude, have you talked to any of the US stunt guys here?
Yeah, we know some of them.
Dave Castillo or?
Yeah, I haven't spoke to anyone in the motocross industry, but there's quite a lot of guys on this new series that they're filming in England. They're all like American LA, so... It's funny how close they are to me when I'm here and they come and watch Supercross and they can't even
There's a large contingent of like motocross guys that have really succeeded in the stunt industry.
In the stunt world, yeah. I know Rich Taylor and his dad does it and stuff like that. So it's mad. It's mad how it can be like a worldwide thing.
Yeah, Rich Taylor, one of my best friends, you know, and he's always doing stunts, this and that. And one day he calls me and goes, "Hey, you want to do a stunt?" And I was like, "All right." And so I actually was in a Samsung Galaxy Super Bowl commercial.
Yeah.
And he's all, "Okay, just bring your bike." He goes, what are you going to bring? I'm all the cow. He goes, "Get white duct tape and make it all white." And I go, "Okay." And then I go and then I duct tape the logos on my gear and everything.
Yeah.
And we jumped a little metal freestyle ramp, like this tall, over a car that was doing donuts.
Yeah.
Like back and forth. It was me, Rich Taylor, Ronnie Renner and Ted Campbell.
Yeah.
It was the most scary thing I've ever done in my life, right?
Yeah, no.
And then the commercial comes out and we're like this big in the television screen, but it paid so well. It was amazing.
Yeah, no. It's crazy, like some of the skill sets that it asks you to do and stuff like that. Like, you meet some mad people. Like, I met Robbie Madison and he said that he'd worked in England a lot and he was shouting me some people that I had worked with in England and stuff like that. So it's a mad industry, you know? So it's crazy. Fortunate to have the opportunity to do it, you know? So
yeah, and I think your motorcycle skills would be desirable.
Yeah, I mean, I ride in England, but I have this stunt bike. It's like got all like the trick levers and like the where you can wheelie it and like take no hands off and stuff like that. And I train on that to learn how to wheelie stoppie on like not just a dirt bike, like on a Kawasaki Ninja or something like that.
Yeah.
And that's hard. Wow. It's difficult. But just try to cover all aspects, bikes, cars, all that type of stuff.
Yeah. Okay, so why just Supercross? I mean, okay, so it's always rainy where you live, right? Like, so motocross is not that enjoyable, but what is it about Supercross that draws you to it?
When I was younger, I always used to ride like the Future West, they were called, now called Arena Cross, and the 50s all the way to the 85s, and I just loved it. Love jumps, love BMX, all that type of stuff. And then kind of come to like not the end of my career in England racing for a professional team. I was riding for Revo at the time, which is the Kawasaki team now. And I was just over it, you know, like going to all these events. Like I was getting help, but not a lot. I was just kind of just figuring it out, being 17. I was done with it. And obviously my dad spent all this money. And he was like, what do you want to do? And I was like, I don't know. And he was like, I think you should do something. And I was like, well, why don't we try supercross? So that was when I come here, 2017. I was 17, done my first one. And it was just building for like a year or two. Obviously, I never rode a proper supercross track. And then, just that one year when I was on the Cowie before I done my back, this all started clicking. And then that's why I loved it. So you can earn some better money here by doing the six races than you can driving around England and doing 30 plus twos for £40. Do you know what I mean? It's like you win no money at all. Yeah. Like, there's only a select few guys that are earning the good money. That's what I think. Like, it's hard to race out here, privateer, when there's like a hub, you know, there's like tracks, there's people that want to help you, and all these companies in England, it's like, there's like, it's so vast and there's so many people trying to do the same thing. It's hard, you know, so.
So this is your sixth?
I think it's like my fifth. Obviously we had that COVID year. I think I missed 1 year to race in Germany, do the ADAC stuff, and then and then that's it. But I love Supercross. You can, I enjoy dirt bikes, so you can ride bikes, earn money, don't have to wash the bike. It's always a plus, so that's that.
Oh, because Supercross is cleaner?
Yeah. Well, probably going to have to wash it this weekend, but most of the time it's not so much maintenance. So for bike parts, I just always look at it like that, you know?
So how does your program work when you come here to the States? Like, do you just plan on staying for 8 weeks or something? Or?
Yeah, I always try to plan I always try to make a plan when I come here so it doesn't spiral out of control and credit card bills don't get too big. So I always set like a goal, and my goal for this year is to do the first four West Coast, see where I'm at. I brought one bike, so I just got a practice bike and a race bike all in one bike. Got the motor done, so the plan is to do the first four. If it goes really well and I think I can end out the championship on like a good, I don't know, good points or national number or something like that, or I think it's worth coming back, then I come back. Or if a team, I get a fill-in ride. But if not, I just don't see the point in traveling all the way to like Salt Lake to maybe make it, or like it's a big expense, isn't it? Like 10 hours there, ride 10 hours back, or it's like it's a long drive. Especially for someone in Europe, like I don't have a house here, I've got to rent stuff, and it is a lot of waiting around just for that one race in Seattle, and then it's a 2 week break. And then
so did you buy a bike and bring it, or did you get here and buy a bike? And
I rode for that team that I was riding for last year, that whatever was going on there. And then obviously made a nice relationship with Jeremy. So I just kind of texted him, stayed in contact, said, mate, I'm coming. I want to buy a bike.
Jeremy at AEO?
Yeah, AEO. And he was like, yeah, I've got you covered. So done that, just kind of done a bit of a deal with the bike and the suspension. And then I was struggling to find a tuner to do the bike. And then I literally my dad typed in, because I didn't know whether I was going to come or not. I just didn't know if it was going to be enough preparation and all that stuff. And then I just kind of thought to myself, like, I'm riding for myself, so what will be, will be. And then I literally just typed in on the internet, California engine tuners, and Race Tech come up straight away. And I rung Andrew from Race Tech. And then literally like that, boom, 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 it was all done. So that was that.
Yeah, they're good people.
Yeah, no, he was a really nice guy, especially with the time difference. I was like losing a day talking to him. So it was hard to make it all happen.
Yeah.
But like literally a week before I was coming here, I was like, don't know if I'm going to come. I don't know if I can make it happen. And then, boom, soon you're aside, a couple $1,000 down. I'm here.
There you go. Hey, we're going to take a quick break here from our sponsors.
I'm Aaron Fletcher.
I'm Christian Craig.
I'm Hunter Lawrence.
Josh Mode.
I'm Cameron McAdoo.
I'm Justin Brayton.
Hey, I'm Alvin Muskin.
I'm Malcolm Stewart.
I'm Jalen Ferrangis.
And I choose OGIO.
And I choose OGIO.
I choose OGIO.
And I choose OGIO.
Baby, you.
Everyone, welcome back to the SML Show presented by OGIO Powersports and Yamaha Motors. Dylan Woodcock. Okay, so you kind of decide last minute, get out here, get a bike from Jeremy at AEO. Who's your mechanic and all that stuff? Like, you have your girlfriend here, is she helping you?
Yeah.
Is she going to hold the pit board for you?
Yeah. My girlfriend's here and I got a friend here out here as well, but he's just like kind of here for if anything ever goes wrong and just a bit of company, you know? I'm just on my own really, doing all the mechanics, the graphics, the bike, the everything. And obviously I have good sponsors and people that are helping me like financially, but all the actual parts, it's just me doing it myself. And obviously like I won't open up the engine because that's just too hairy for me.
Yeah, so can you make a 250 four-stroke last through all the practice and four races?
Yeah, I'm pretty good with changing oils and stuff like that and checking all the clutch, and the race tech motor is solid, so it lasts a long time.
Yeah, how much is actually done to it? Is it just like
it's just like the top end and a piston and just light work, you know, like with the with the fuel and the ECU here, you can make a pretty solid bike out of that. But at this time of year, just before A1, I have loads of people here, like girlfriend, dad, and friends, and then straight after A1, everyone just disappears, you know what I mean? It's everyone goes back to doing their normal work, and I'm just out here having fun, you know? So that's normally how it works.
Okay, because I can remember seeing you for the first time like a few years ago. I walked up, and I think you're in the tunnel or something, and I was like, that guy's last name is Woodcock. That's sick.
Yeah.
But what has been the best result that you've accomplished here in the States?
I think it's the 17th in the main. Mm-hmm. I've always been a kind of a guy, like I always worry so much about making the actual main event. So by the time I come to the main event, I've put so much effort into it, I'm just toast, you know what I mean? Like I never get a good shot at the main event, which that what I've been trying to work on this kind of like short period of off season that I've had, is to be good in the whoops, and the main event is the main goal, to score a good result for someone that's watching to go, you know what, it's probably time to give him a shot, or let's give him an opportunity for a round. Because if someone offered me a bike just to ride for one round, I'd probably take it, you know?
Yeah. So what's your main event, like qualify, not qualify?
I mean, like last year we had six rounds and I qualified for four. Mm-hmm. One I got taken out, and the other one I crashed on the start, I think. So that was just that, you know? So most time I do make it. I'm pretty consistent with making the mains and stuff like that. So if I don't make it out of the heat, I always kind of make it out of the LCQ, you know? Mm-hmm. So try to stay away from the LCQs.
High pressure, right?
It's not high pressure. You just upset people that you don't want to upset, or because that's how it is. You're gritting it out and you don't. It's always a nice guy that gets it or something like that, you know?
Yeah. So if you said you had a rival here, like a hometown rival, would it be Walsh?
He's not, Walsh, maybe, yeah, he's an English team, so I wouldn't say he's like a rival. He's a good rider, you know what I mean? But yeah, he's from the same country, he's New Zealand or wherever he's from, but same like the team and stuff like that.
Yeah.
So I guess so. I guess it's just that they're a big team and it's just, I'm the one man army.
Yeah. Okay, so I saw you last at Straight Rhythm.
Yeah.
Right? And you're on a Suzuki that didn't run that good.
Yeah.
It's funny because I was like, oh, sick, Woodcock's here.
Yeah, yeah.
And I was watching him all day. It was obvious to me that your bike was holding you back. Yeah. Like, what was the deal with your Straight Rhythm effort?
So I was actually riding for a team called SR75, a guy called Jeff. He runs a team in Europe. He's like known for doing arena cross and like French. And I never rode in like French supercross. And he normally just has French riders, so he let me come in, and we was riding a Suzuki 250 in France, and I'd never even been to France, and it was hard to train for it and ride and race it at the same time, and it's different out there. Like it's the tracks are like riding on this floor, and it's like 12 o'clock at night, the lights are like flickering on and off, and like you can barely see, and these French kids are just risking it for a biscuit, and got the opportunity to go there with him, and it was all going well, and then we come to Straight Rhythm. And he just said, do you want to do it? Because he was good friends with Eric Bernard. Mm-hmm. And I'd done the Stark thing and got to know him a little bit, so that helped. So I just thought, yeah, we'll come out and do this. Come out, and he had this bike. It was just like, it wasn't running too great. And then Stank Dog, I know him from just like laughing, joking in the tunnel and that, this and that. And he just throws a carb at me, like across the pit, like just throws it up the floor and just went, put that on, man. And I'm like, why? And he's like, trust me. I'm like, all right. I literally, right, the guy bolted it on the bike, put it on the throttle, and he adjusted the throttle, I literally revved it and it was just a total different bike. Rode really? It, yeah, and it was mint. It was slow, obviously, because it was an actual 125, yeah. But it worked. So Stank Dog knows his two strokes for sure.
That's awesome.
Yeah, it's mad. But it was funny. It was a good experience. Like, it's mad. Like, that jump, you know that tunnel jump? That
over
was
the
scariest jump I've ever jumped, mate.
Really?
Like, you take off and you hear it's like, boom, boom, boom. It's like BMX, do you know what I mean? Like, you can hear it, like, and then that knuckle on the end was just scary because the landing was just like, it was like 100 meters long, wasn't it?
Yeah.
So I just made sure I hit it with everything I had.
Wow.
And just about got it.
What is it like racing the straight rhythm without turns? I mean, and was it hard to keep track of what the combos were and everything? Because I know they have those reset scrub walls.
The resets?
Yeah.
To be honest, after like two or three runs, it was pretty easy to figure it out. But definitely weird just going straight, like, and I feel like this year, where it was on the beach, it was a little bit smaller than it normally is, so it was a little bit easier to figure out. But, mate, like, going off that grid onto the thing, when it started raining a little bit, that was scary,
did
mate.
The, like, did the grid get slippery?
I think I just hit first. I think I started in second gear and clicked third, like, off the thing, so it would just be like, brrr, up, and it spun, and I was like, nose manualing down the downside. But, no, it was an awesome experience, and thanks to the guys that made it happen, really.
Yeah.
So that, I think I was that fun on the first Euros from England to come over and do it, you know, so it was a good experience.
Yeah, that was super cool. So what do you think about the whole California scene and all that? I mean, do you like coming here, or is it just like a lot of us that live here in California, we're kind of jailed, traffic and you know, all that. But like, what's it like coming from where you live to here?
To be fair, traffic where I live is close to London. So it's like I live in a town or a city called Essex, or like Raleigh. Mm-hmm. And it's like you have the hub of the M25 and it's traffic there. So the traffic's not really a problem here for me. Mm-hmm. I'd say like it's different, you know, like in England, people are partying at like 18 year old and then they're like not veterans, but they're like retired by the time they're like 23 because they're starting their jobs or whatever.
Yeah.
Here, like the party scene, it's like 21 and then it's just like they're almost adults, you know what I mean? So it's just different in aspects and hanging out with people and cinemas and stuff like that. It's all different how you guys do it, you know, so it's definitely an experience coming out here each year.
Nice. Hey, one more quick break here from our sponsors. We're back for one more with Dylan. Everyone, welcome back to the SML Show presented by OGIO Powersports and Yamaha Motors. All right, during the break, you just said you got popcorn at the movies and they put butter on it. It freaked you out.
Yeah.
Right.
I mean, me and my girlfriend went to go watch Avatar last night and she said, can we have sweet and salted? And then she just looked at her like weird. And she just went, oh, there's butter over there. You can add like seasoning. Like we get sweet or salted. Like that's the two options. And I put the butter on it and it was like putting motor oil on it, if I'm honest. Like, my fingers were all greasy. It wasn't very nice.
What is your favorite US food to eat when you're here?
the spot down the road, Dave's Hot Chicken.
Oh, you like that?
Unbelievable.
Dude, when they opened up, Chase and I went and got it, and we were just like,
really? Oh, you got to go
it
back.
It was too hot.
Oh, you can get mild. I like spice. I do like spice.
Okay.
But like that's like closest you can get to like Nashville chicken type thing. It's unreal. I really like that spot.
You know what my favorite thing in the UK is? Mushy peas.
Mushy peas?
Love
like
it.
A fish and with fish and chips?
Yeah.
I like fish and chips, or I'd say my favorite kind of fast food in England would be like a Nando's or something. We don't have big chains like Dave's Hot Chicken. Mm-hmm. We just have KFC, McDonald's. And
yeah, Nando's is a name that comes up all the time.
Yeah.
When I talk to UK guys.
Yeah. It's just like a franchise. Like your Chipotle.
Oh, okay.
Like same top two.
Okay, so last time I saw you before Straight Rhythm was in Barcelona.
Yeah.
At the Stark Future Varg launch. But I'm like all tired and jet lagged. And I think I rode that day.
Yeah.
And so I was on this super high from riding the bike, and I'm walking out of the buffet at the hotel, and you come walk in, and you're all, hey, what's up? I'm all, hey, what's up? And then Renee's with me, so who is that? I'm all, I have no idea. And he goes, I think that was Woodcock.
Yeah.
Because you cut your hair off.
I cut my hair off, yeah.
Yeah, like last year you had long hair, and like this year.
Yeah, she's going out to cut that all off.
Clean cut guy.
Yeah.
But okay, pro rider guy. Versus old, washed up, never was journalist. I was completely enamored with the Stark.
Yeah.
What did you go to Barcelona with as like expectations?
I just went with no expectation. I'd rode a Surron, and that was it really. I had no expectations on anything or how it was going to handle. And I was speaking with a guy that was working there. He actually doesn't work there no more. But I spoke to him, and that's how I kind of got the connect. And then there was a company, kind of like Swaps, called Dirt Hub in England.
Yeah.
And they was like, do you want to go? And I was like, for sure, 100% go. Technology, all of this type of stuff. Had no expectations whatsoever, probably like yourself. And I jumped on the bike, and it was just freaky for like one lap. And then as soon as I got used to it, it was the best thing since sliced bread. I loved it. Like, I couldn't believe how skinny it was. Like the whole Rhino thing, wearing knee brace, like knee pads. I reckon if you wore knee pads on that bike, it would be too
skinny.
Yeah, too skinny, because it was so nice to ride. It was like all the controls and stuff was just like, it felt right. It felt like it would been out for many years. It didn't feel like
it didn't feel like some, like the Alta felt. Like
I never rode an Alta personally, but like people saying like, oh yeah, they tried this one and then this one and it got better over the bikes. Like this one they got, and it was just legit from there.
Yeah.
So it was amazing to have the opportunity. Like you see, Kenny's just went and tried it because probably he's heard from people speaking and spreading the word. And what a bike. It's amazing. Yeah.
It's funny because I went and I was super skeptical because I really didn't have, I had bad experiences on the Alta. Like the first day I was riding it, I think we were talking with Sleater about it, but
yeah.
I crashed at Glen Helen, and when I picked it up, I twisted the throttle.
Because we spoke with and Sleater and Renee.
Yeah.
I remember that.
But man, I got there, but it was such a regimented intro, right?
Yeah.
It was like, okay, you can go ride for two laps.
Yeah.
Then you go ride two laps. Okay, come off. And then, okay, two laps, and they're going to film you.
Yeah.
And it was so regimented before we had the free time to do what we wanted.
Yeah.
Like I was so nervous and everything. Like, oh, I don't want to be the one guy that crashes this thing and breaks it or something. But
I kind of jumped on it and just started ripping it.
Did you?
Yeah.
See, I didn't know what to expect.
Like, I got on it and just started ripping. And like, there was like one lap, there was two people coming to the fence, and then there was a couple more. And then like the third, because you got three laps, didn't you?
Yeah.
And then they all came. And then like, I was the first guy in because like everyone else maybe was just like, but I never feel, like, I'm not the best test guy. So like, I didn't feel the benefits unless I was going full gas, like getting a bit out of shape or something like that. And I come in and they was all like with their stopwatches, and they're all a bit different, they're like looking at the stopwatch, looking at me, and I'm like, all good guys, have I done something wrong? And they're like, yeah, you're just going pretty good, like you like that bike? I was like, yeah, that's good. Tried the Husqvarna, and then they're all smiling and stuff, and I was like, what's up? They was like, you don't even want to see the comparison, which is probably the same for you, the comparison. They obviously someone must have like searched me on Instagram while I was there, and they must have seen that I don't ride motocross that often, and it was all supercross, and they had that supercross track down there, and I got the opportunity to ride it, and mate, it was just unreal.
Good on supercross?
Good on supercross, because it was like, there was this one gear, and and you're so in between gears on a supercross track, there's no option to not be, and that's all you have to worry about is your feet position and just riding it. And mate, it was wicked to ride. Just strange on the noise.
Yeah.
On the down ramp on supercross.
Yeah, you hear the tires.
Tires.
You hear the chain slap.
Boom, and then the chain slap, and then it's kind of the shock afterwards. It's like it's like three noises.
And there's some sort of noise from the bodywork or something, but it's like you sound like you're on a junky bike. It's like
I think it's the plastics, because like you know the plastic kind of slides off. I think when it lands, it may like kind of
move a little.
But I think they was like putting pads under it. It was an amazing bike, like even like down to the what do you call it, the chain block.
Yeah,
like being a privateer, round them 13 mil bolts off all the time, and I had that little Allen key bit where you just thought that was mint. So
I think I did the initial ride, and then they put us on the gas bikes.
Yeah,
and so I was like, oh yeah, the gas bike, I'll learn how to ride this track.
Yeah,
there was two jumps I didn't do on the gas bike, but I did them on the Stark the next time I got on.
Yeah.
And I think off my GoPro, it was 6 seconds difference.
Was it down the hill, the double?
The double down the
hill?
That's
where I nearly crashed.
Huh?
That's where I nearly crashed.
Really?
Because it was sharp, and then it was still down the hill. So I kind of like let off the throttle, and it had a tiny little engine brake. So it went, whoa, and I kind of like dropped. And I grabbed some throttle, and it just went, what?
Right? When you gas it in the air, it goes...
It goes like this. So it's almost like a rear brake. It's just new style of riding, isn't it? Instead of back braking it and revving the throttle to do that, you don't even have to back brake it. You can just prep and it just kind of but no, what an experience, mate. Like I've been hitting them guys up to race supercross on that bike and do all sorts of stuff, so hopefully somewhere down the line I can meet again with the Stark, because it was
it's funny the amount of haters there are, huh? Like on the reviews and stuff.
I do understand, like, there's diehard two-stroke guys and they just live for two strokes and all that type of stuff and gas and all that stuff. But like people that drive Teslas and have got that like experience of how convenient it is and all stuff like that and how convenient the bike is, especially for me in Europe, having a supercross track, I could build one in my garden and all you're going to hear is the tire slap, you know what I mean? And because it's bad in Europe and all that type of stuff and noise. So I think it's going to be pros and cons around the world. Depends where you take it.
Yeah. Well, Renee and I both came home and ordered them.
Yeah, I've got one on order now.
You do
too? Yeah, as soon as they come to England, I think I've got like one of the first ones. So
nice.
Yeah, I've got some good ideas planned up for that, for sure.
Yeah, probably some good videos. And
yeah, I know Josh Hill, half decent, and like just speaking with him, like going around like freeways and doing all stuff. No one's ever done anything like that in Europe. And I feel like this bike could open the doors to do anything like film work.
Yeah.
All kind of like free riding in England, so we'll see. Hopefully it comes out soon.
You're going to go film near Big Ben or something?
Yeah. Ride up Big Ben.
Yeah. Right on. Well, hey, we're out of time, but it's certainly good to have you back here in Southern California.
Yeah, thanks for having me on the show.
Good luck for the first four, and hopefully things go well and you come back.
Yeah, hopefully I get a fill-in or I'm able to come back.
Yeah, right on.
Thank you.
All right, guys, thanks for watching. And what's the number this year?
260.
260. Yep. Keep an eye out for number 260. On the track. See you next time.